Good afternoon. I am Professor Michael Flyer from the Ukrainian Research Institute of Harvard University, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the final seminar for the fall term for HURI. This time we have two speakers, in fact. The first speaker who will give the main presentation will be Susana Torres Prieto, and there will be a follow-up by Konstantin Bondarenko, our IT specialist, who will talk about the MAPA project. So Susana Torres Prieto is assistant professor of humanities at IE University in Spain since 2015. She teaches a wide variety of courses, I must say there, from political theory to the rise of the novel to empires and the rhetoric of power. She is also the academic director of humanities at the university and director of its humanities center. She received her bachelor and master's degree from Universidad Complutense de Madrid in Spain, and then followed that with a Doctor Europaeus degree in Slavic philology at Cambridge University, writing a dissertation on traveling in the Russian Bulini, the hero and his journeys, and then went off to Paris, lucky woman, to do a diplôme postdoctorat at the École Pratique des Hautes Études there, writing a dissertation in French on literary genres used to create an image of power in the princely dynasties of medieval Rus. She has very interesting publications, one that is coming out next year from Routledge, The Early Slavs, the first centuries of Eastern Europe, and Los Antiguos Eslavos, which was published in 2020. She has co-edited collections, a new perspectives on late antiquity in the Eastern Roman Empire in 2014, and Medieval Slavic Studies, New Perspectives for Research in 2009. Her book translations include Cantos Épicos Rusos, the first translation into Spanish of an anthology of Russian Bulini. She has numerous articles and book chapters on Slavic philology and Slavic medieval culture, and is involved in research projects on the literary creation of the Alexander the Great myth in European literatures and a critical edition of four Slavic apocryphal gospels. She's here at Slavic at Harvard this semester on a grant from the Ukrainian Research Institute to work on what you're going to hear about today, the Golden Age of Kievan Rus. Let me say a few words about Konstantin Bondarenko. He's our information technology professional, now in his 20th year at HURI. He's also project manager of MAPA at the Ukrainian Institute. Kostya is our indispensable expert on all things IT, helping us to navigate the oceans of new technology. He has expanded our sites by designing and developing websites, producing databases, and creating GIS, that's geographic information systems, maps, and web applications. For the MAPA project, Digital Atlas of Ukraine program, he has worked on all of the different modules established to date, and has presented MAPA projects at a number of conferences. He's currently working on joint GIS projects between the Institute and its partners in the United States and abroad. So now it's my great pleasure to turn the floor over to Professor Torres Prieto to talk on the Golden Age of Kievan Rus.
Thank you, Michael. I hope you can all see my screen now. Yes?
Yes.
Thank you very much. Well, it's a pleasure and an honor to be here at HURI presenting this project, which, as you will see, is not really mine. It's really a HURI project, as I will be able to explain to you along the way. But before we get to that part, which would be the end part of this presentation that Kostya would take over, allow me to say a few introductory words, which is why on earth we are doing this right now. As many of you are aware, hopefully you listened in person to him saying, Ihor Shevchenko had a wonderful theory that I would call, for shorthand, the theory of dogs. I'm not going to explain exactly in the terms in which Professor Shevchenko explained the theory of dogs, but has to do with how do we, in medieval Slavic studies, constantly revisit certain texts once and again, and which narrows our understanding, I would say, that's me, not him, our understanding of the richness and the complexity of all the literature and artistic representations and demonstrations that we could find in the 300 years before the in what we call the pre-Mongol Kievan Rus. There is indeed, and it has been for the last few decades, a constant revisitation of what is of a prefigured canon. And this constant revisitation that you know comes not only in Isoslavic studies, but in general, is based on different ideas that I would just throw to the floor for your pondering. One is, of course, the contemporary perception of quality. What is quality depends, or what is perceived as quality is going to depend on how do we create the canon. The ideological standpoint, which cannot be absolutely ruled out, an ideological standpoint would give you a different canon or would give one a different canon depending on where one stands. There is, of course, and it has been for many years, and I would say this is particularly important in the question of medieval studies, not only Slavic, a tacit agreement on the concept of the genuine. We put in the canon those works that we consider to be genuine or that we can attribute directly to a given author or a nation, for example. The idea of authorship, of course, is always circulating in the idea of the canon. Who did what? Who wrote what? Was it completely original? Was it copied? Was it semi-copied? Was it an idea, you know, that just popped in his or her head? And finally, and particularly in talking about medieval studies, trying to put all these ideas into an idea of what a canon is or should be has, I would say, populated all European medieval literary histories with a collections of what I would call originals and unicates. Wonderful works whose transcendence even among its contemporaries is to be debatable, but that had been considered usually since the late 18th, 19th century, as those works that speak the soul or the mind of a nation. Very often, those works are found in one manuscript, two manuscripts, but they are considered those pearls or jewels of the crown around which loads of works, publications, conferences, and whole scholarly lives seem to revolve around. In 2017, Lars Boje Mortensen from the Center of Medieval Literature in the University of Odense wrote I consider one of the most enlightening articles on what do we do and how do we create the canon of medieval literature in the Middle Ages. And he gave a few important ideas that I am going to try to discuss in the case of Slavic studies here today. Some of these I'm sure many of you in the audience would know about, others maybe not. So I'm just going to review them very quickly. First of all, the question of accessibility. If there are no publications of a certain work, if there are no editions, no translations, no materials, it's very difficult that the works enter into the canon anyway. One has to bear in mind, as Lars very well points out, that in the Middle Ages, no two books, instead of no two material supports, were exactly alike. That it starts happening when the printing press comes into action, but certainly not before. And therefore, trying to come to a criteria of a single one text becomes extremely complicated. And I would add that in the case of Slavic, it becomes even more complicated for reasons many of you also know and have suffered in your own critical editions. There is, of course, that is almost taken for granted, but is I think it's worth pointing out and repeating it, an absence of copyright or any firm idea or intellectual property. But of course, that clashes with the aforementioned idea of the authorship, as we will see in a moment. And then we have, I would say, the first conundrum, if we try to transfer what Lars says into East Slavic medieval literature, which is the problem between the canon and the translation. Because one understands that the medieval literary canons are based on vernaculars. And therefore, if the work is not originally written in the language whose literature we are canonizing, it sometimes is understood, and indeed so is understood by large, that should not be directly included in a national canon. And that is a very valid point, of course, as we will see. But we have a problem when we have a literature, like medieval East Slavic literature, is so abundant in translations. We're going to explore this problem a little bit more. At the end of the article, Lars comes up with a separation, a four-part separation of, yes, into canons and what he calls canons and archives. And he tries to define which works should go into which sort of part of the canon, the layers. So you have the high canon, global impact, multimedia and popular presence, in popular culture, domination in the scholarship. For example, I don't know, Dante's Divina Commedia, or the Canterbury Tales, or something that almost everybody knows about, even from the time, or the Poema del Mio Cid, something everybody knows from high school days. Then you have the broad canon, mostly country specific, not known across the national borders. So people who are not from that nation would not be aware of it. Is what we would call also the scholars' canons. It can contain numerous texts, of course, but they are the texts that only sort of you learn when you go to college, or you work with when you go to college, and for the rest of your life when you become an academic. Then the differentiation between the canon and the archive. The open archive would be those texts that are usually referred to by specialists, and therefore we all know more or less where to find them. We know the editions. We know who works on those texts. So-and-so has published an article. He or she has dedicated, I don't know how many years to work on that text or that author. And those are would be the open archive. And then he goes down to, or narrows down the possibilities to what he called the closed archive, which is those very marginal, sometimes identified, very often unedited texts that one discovers one day and hopes and, you know, to communicate that in lots of conferences, and people become or not very enthusiastic about it, but that so far has not been certainly not in the high canon and not even in the broad canon. Now, what is left out, according to Lars, from a typical medieval literary canon, therefore, would be the Bible, because it's translated, would be the classics, because they are also translated, and because they don't belong to any particular national culture. The fathers, all the patristic and all the Christian authors, and also, of course, the apocrypha and the pseudepigrapha, because they are also translations in the majority of cases, and therefore they don't belong to any, for two reasons, as the others, because they are translations and because they don't belong to any one national tradition. And it should be left out as well, anything composed before the medieval period. Whenever the medieval period starts, which it could be another discussion that we might have, because as we all know, and we will see when Kostia presents the project at the end, our medieval period is quite late by comparison to other medieval periods in European letters. Now, the majority of us, when we approached the study of East Slavic literature, or certainly of us of a certain generation, the other day a younger colleague said, well, I never actually opened the books, I only looked at it online. But anyway, the Biblioteca Literatura Drevnej Rusi is more or less where we all started at one point, or who we had to go back at one point, because it was considered to contain the canon of the medieval East Slavic literature. And I have just made a quick list of the five first volumes and the works they contain. So some of these would be very familiar to all of you: the Sermon of Law and Grace by Hilarion, the Primary Chronicle, the Tale of Boris and Gleb. If you go to volume number two, you have what Lihachov called translated literature, and therefore what you have is Skonsonen Cyril, the Life of Wenceslas of Bohemia, the Izborniki, Barlaman Yosafat, and so on and so forth. Number three is religious and biblical tales, and therefore you have parts of the Bible, Apocrypha, so the Epigrapha, and so on. Finally, volume number four on the 12th century, subtitled by Lihachov himself as the literature of the time of the lay of the Igor's campaign, the famous Slovopolku Igreve, you would have all these works, including the Slovo, of course. I'm not going to enter into that one. And not number five, the 13th century, and I'll stop here because our project goes until the arrival of the Mongols to Kiev. You would have all of these tales, narrations, some of them translations, about works produced at that time in Kievan Rus. So far, so good. Now, if we were to go back to what Lars had discussed and I presented shortly before, we would have to then reassess the list of works. First of all, do we separate, for example, the Commune of Vladimir as a separate work, or the Instruction of Vladimir Monomakh as a separate work? Or do we have to just label them or work them or set them within the container where they are presented? To which extent we can separate or extract or extract the works and create new works that clearly were not separate for the people who copied them. The second question, of course, if you have to take away all the translations, you take completely the second volume out, nothing would stand in that canon. You take the third volume completely out, nothing would stand in that canon, since they are all translations, Christian apocrypha, pseudepigrapha, and so on. You will go the volume four, and you would have some things, but you would certainly not have the Birchbach letters, because they are not a literary production. And you would, in the volume five, have some of the works, but then some of them you might want to consider as translations and therefore exclude them as well. So when I was preparing this paper, and particularly when I was preparing this project, I was wondering, what is it? Where would I put all these works that we have in the traditional East Slavic literary canon? And you might agree or not with my choices. And this is, you know, for the Q&A moment, but you would say, what are the, you know, from all these works, what is included in the high canon? Well, the Lay of Igrason campaign, you know, aside from the origin question, and the Primary Chronicle, of course, that everybody knows. So probably the high canon would include one or two. The broad canon here, most of us would agree that this is what we teach in our courses, and that when we engage with our students, and this is like the minimum a good medieval Slavic person should have read at some point in his or her life. Then you would have the open archive, the text regularly referred to by specialists. I have to say that I had problems, for example, where to put the Sermon on Daniel Zatochnik. Would I put it in the broad canon? I put it there, but I also put it here because I wasn't sure actually how, where would I, you know, place it. But a text regularly referred by a specialist, so probably all of this. And then you would have the very closed archive. Those would be the marginal, identified. And of course, since they are marginal, unidentified, are unedited. This is just my placement of some of the works in the collection made by Lihachov, because there are many that would not have been included because they have not been edited yet. So that would be have to grow. Now, talking to Lars about this presentation the other day, I asked him and said, well, so what do we do when works like my Daniel Zatochnik, where do I put it? And he said, well, you know, the text can definitely move between the layers, and one would say, you know, works at some point become more popular for whatever the reason, and they jump from one layer to another. With two caveats. One, going back into four is very difficult. So if one text has already been edited, known, and has jumped from the closed archive to the open archive, taking it back to the closed archive once it is known is sort of complicated. And in practice, he said, also it's very difficult to enter one if the work is not already there, if it has not accumulated this sort of popularity over the decades that suddenly one becomes, one. I remember when Antonio Banderas gave, portrayed Ivan Fatlan in a Hollywood film called The Warrior Number 13. Maybe we could put, you know, Ivan Fatlan Rizales in number one, but I don't think this is going to be the case. It's very difficult when a work has not acquired that level of popularity that one can just, you know, throw it back there. We have then a much complex issue and a serious one, which is how do we separate the works from the manuscripts? And we have a problem, as all medieval Slavists know, because we have a problem with the colophons, we have a problem of dating of the manuscripts, we have the problem of the dating of the texts. But when one crosses those two sets of evidence, it is really surprising. For years, I've been working with one of those books that I inherited, which I don't know, here, from the private library of Vladimir Rodoff in Paris, which is a catalog coordinated by Schmidt about the manuscript books found in libraries in the former USSR that belong or can be dated to centuries 11 to 13. Now, when you look at this, more or less, this is what you have. So you have lots of works used in liturgy. By the way, the table it has only things like for my own consumption, but the little numbers in red means that these manuscripts are in OCS. The when you see blue is all Serbian, when you see purple is all Bulgarian. Those are volumes or manuscripts found in the libraries. Notwithstanding the fact that many of them have been lost, and notwithstanding the fact that many of them have traveled, just to give you an impression of what was there in the majority. And this only takes me to the 13th century, to the middle of the 13th century. So Missals, Evangelies, Isborniki, we'll go back to the Isborniki question in a moment, Mineias, Hagiography, Chrysostom, some Patieriki, some works or that the people who made the catalogs decided to name with the author, Cyril of Jerusalem, Gregory of Nazianzus, John the Exarch, John of Damascus, usually because those volumes had exclusively, which is not the main, as we all know, is not the main is not the main trend to have exclusively the works of one author bound together. Vers Mineia, Apostoli, of course, some works more famous than others, the Ladder of Divine Ascent, the commentaries of Hippolytus, but then more and more and more in forms of liturgy. The Kontakion, the homilies, the Triodion, the Paramieniki, and so on and so forth. Nothing of this is what we were told it was in the literary canon of the previous collection, or indeed any of the collections. So what do we do with these two forms of evidence? That was the conundrum. And this is where the MAPA project really starts. So now I think Megan is going to put in your chat or something the links to the, so you can start exploring the MAPA project. My new proposal is we have to come up with a different way of understanding all the literary production in Kiev and Rus that does not falsify the evidence by giving the impression of having only one, two, or three forms of literature that has to take into account other things that maybe are not taken into account in medieval canons. So my new proposal is the following. First of all, it has to take into account the difference between canon and archive. And more importantly, as I see it, it has to leave the users to decide their own hierarchy. And therefore it has to be comprehensive. The idea of the MAPA project is that as Kostya used to tell me, you just load everything in. So the idea is like, we're going to give as many possibilities as possible, as many access as possible. So the idea is that the narrow archive or the closed archive that we saw in the four layers before becomes the open archive. And you as a searcher or as a researcher decide what is it that you want to do. And this is the great advantage of working in a digital environment rather than working in a closed book, of course, that goes without saying. Second, it takes into account necessarily translations, because as many of us know who have been working with them, a translation in the Slavic can clearly become, can clearly become a new version, and is one of the key places where scribes do innovation. They innovate by adding or cutting or abridging or mixing or parts of text that then with which they then conform new versions. I don't want to stain very much, but I have just finished a book on the Alexanders, as many of you know, because I've been talking about it for far too long, in which one of the Alexander versions, the one of the translations of the Beta Greek, the manuscript L, includes in itself Hamartolos, Epiphanius of Salamis, some Josephus, and so it is really a new Alexander. And one could say, well, yes, it's an Alexander, it's just a translation. No, it's not only a translation, it's a new form of understanding, a new version. And that is part of how medieval Slavic scribes understood innovation within the text. In the case of the Apocrypha, this happens even more often. In the stands, and the third basic tenet to conform this new MAPA project is the understanding literary culture as a monastic culture. And therefore, it is not possible, really, I don't think it's possible to exclude biblical texts and Christian authors. And it has to include, because of, there is another discussion pending, and sometimes people are unaware of the openness of the biblical canon in Orthodoxy. And therefore it has to necessarily include the Apocrypha and the Pseudepigrapha, because they are part of the culture of Orthodoxy and not only in medieval times. Therefore, taking them out, because our Protestant canon, biblical canon, does not accept them, would be again another misunderstanding on what was that it conformed the literary culture of what I have called the golden age of Kievan Rus. What are the criteria then for creating all these new database? Well, I think it has to be hybrid, and it has to account for both manuscripts and what we call literary works. And in that sense, both understandings that I explained to you before are right. Yes, we can separate parts and label them so they are searchable, and a literary work sometimes attested in a very late manuscript, I think, as I will explain to you in a moment, should be included, because there are reasons to, or there is enough evidence to understand that people at the time knew about it. I would, unlike the catalog that Schmidt did for everything that can be found in a library, regardless of where they come from. The question of origin doesn't bother me too much, but the question of language does to a certain extent, because one has to sort of cut somewhere. So I would only include the works in East Slavic that were during the time of the pre-Mongol, Kievan Rus. Not everything found in Kievan Rus that can be remotely dated to the 13th century, the 13th century. Because the MAPA project, as Kostya is going to explain to you in a moment, is a geolocalization project, we need to open the possibility and work with the possibility of linking works to places, which is the point. Because the point, as Kostya is going to explain to you in a moment, is not that there was one very famous monastery that was called the Kiewopucherski, which was the photograph that you had at the beginning of the advertisement of this talk. It's like that there are actually about 28 or 29 that we have managed to track down. Those were counted for 28 or 29 monastic scriptoria, where texts were being copied and culture was being done, created. And therefore, if we can try to link them, we will try to link them. Now, this is easier said than done, particularly with the lack of colophons that we have, because when we have the colophons of one single library, that's very easy. But when we have not colophons and several libraries, that becomes slightly complicated. However, we're going to do it one by one and sort of ad hoc classification system. I will explain to you in a moment. When there are no early extant manuscripts, but as I was saying before, enough evidence of early knowledge or circulation of the work, then the work should be linked to a monastery if we can, or to a church if we can, because those are both geographic points, and if not, to a general place, even a city. When there is no colophon, as we indeed have very few, although I have to say I found more than I was expecting to find, but anyway, or any possible identifier of the place, both they have to be linked to, you know, we'll try to use all the philological tools at our disposal, paleographic, decodological, or historical linguistics, to try to link that work, that a manuscript, that to a particular place. So to a certain extent, we could also sort of leave Kiev and Novgorod for a while and try to see the bigger picture, which I think there was. Kostya is now going to show you, when I finish, which I'm going to finish quite soon, how to search the how to work with it with the MAPA module. But just to make you know, to try to explain to you what for me would be the ideal form of organizing all this knowledge, there has to be a mixed system, as I explained before, between the two approaches that we have been exploring. Years ago, I did a theory of that I call my theory of the building blocks, which is not probably mine anyway, but it certainly inspired very much on the first time I listened to David Birnbaum explaining the contents of the Florilegia, Slavic Florilegia in Madrid in like some a time that seems to be in the remote past. Every single block, every single text has to be identified. The fact that we identify the only two works that coincide in the label between the description of the catalog and the works published by in the Biblioteca Literaturi are Izbornik 1073, Izbornik 1076. But unless you know what are you looking for in either of these Izborniki, or you are a knowledgeable person already, or you know that Anastasios Sinaita is there, or Agapetus, or any of the authors that you've already known, it's actually impossible to search them. And it's not only impossible sometimes for Slavics arriving to the trade, it's even more impossible for those colleagues, not specialists in Slavic literature, who nevertheless would be very interested in knowing that oh, do you also have a translation of whatever, Flavius Josephus, one of the fathers of the desert, or the apocryphal of the Acta Pilati, or do you also have that? So one has to break down and label them so they are searchable. So in that sense, what the work that David has been doing in the last years is absolutely essential in the understanding of how we are going to break down and work with the textual evidence that we have. All the headings, more importantly, and I found that when I was working, Michael mentioned the project of the Apocryphal Gospels, have to be given according to international labeling. Because in order for us to be able to communicate with our fellow medievalists or fellow biblical scholars or fellow theologians or whatever, or any other people who don't know the trade of the medievalist Slavic, it's very useful. And certainly it has been done for the Patrologia Greca, but it has been done also for the Apocrypha. It has been done for the classical works. And there are international agreed upon labels that people have to know, so they are searchable, they will actually be accessible. Another question is whether the text itself is accessible. Fine, but for example, you know, for years, Hury published this wonderful collection that you all remember, the Harvard Library of Early Ukrainian Literature, wonderful translations into English by great scholars, but the others have to know that they are there. So for me, it's important, as when you do a good catalog, that the labeling is in agreement for biblical, patristic, and classical works, searchable in English for anybody else who is not from Slavic studies. As you will see when Kostya presents the wonderful pop-up images of the monasteries and so forth, there are going to be links to images, to editions, to further information, and that will be displayed for anybody who looks at that. And then to a certain extent, what we have, the most time-consuming part until now has been labeling, cataloging the categories. What is it that we want to do searchable? What is it that we think is important, not only for us, but as I say, and this is the vocation of this MAPA project, that is useful for anybody, and not only medieval Slavists, to search and to look for avenues of research and mutual collaboration. Beyond the literary canon, and that's, we were joking the other day with Kostya, maybe because we are already bored with all the things that we have to do, but we also want to include something which goes slightly beyond the literary canon. Why? Because, well, because the literary canon doesn't grow on its own, doesn't get fixed on its own, and certainly fertilizes and dialogues with the rest of artistic representations that you can find at a given time at a certain place. So since we were bored, we're going to include, and I would have to thank publicly Alyosha Gipius, who has very generously going to lend us loads of his data, the Birchbark letters in Novgorod, and not only Novgorod, the epigraphy that they are also currently working on, and certainly, which is the beginning, we are all starting to do this, the church and building decoration. Because at the end of the day, the idea is that when you're working on a character, you're working on St. Michael is here, or Boris Iglev, or whatever, that you are actually able to bring to your screen everything that was done, said, written, painted, frescoed, constructed, built on that particular saint. Now, that is what the dialogue between not only the literary canon, but the literary culture starts with the rest of artistic representations. And that is what I think it enriches, and hopefully we can stop thinking about the theory, Shevchenko's theory of dogs, enriches the panorama of everything that was done, said, listened to, read, talked about in those 300 years. And therefore, going back to the idea that MAPAs are projects linked to a place, that they are geolocalized, and that they can be updated, of course, the point is to try to make this as rich as possible, as accessible as possible for others, but always trying to link it to the best of our abilities to a place that was part of Kievan Rus. Now, first things first, I have very few minutes left. I'm just going to introduce, before passing the floor to Kostya, I'm just going to introduce a few concepts that we have sort of come across when we were drawing this first module of the MAPA. And it has not been easy, but it has been lots of fun. So we have, and I know that some eyebrows are already going up, we have not established borders between principalities, because we have taken, or we have understood, that the places are the pivot. So everything revolves around a city, a place, a monastery, and Kostya is going to explain to you now the relevance of those places with respect to one another. And therefore, in order to also, of course, to avoid the messy question of all the dynastic and interesting wars between the principalities of Kievan Rus, we have linked the places together as clusters. As clusters that it is my understanding were translating that famous shorthand of the land of the Zimlya of a different dynastic branch. So the patrimony of the Kinyaz, the Ochina, the Vochina, of a given prince. And in that sense, I have to say that after rereading the bibliography, or almost all the bibliography that I had used all my life, of Kievan Rus, and in agreement with what Janet Martin says, despite all the dynastic conflicts, the wars, the endless contestations, people were aware that certain cities, with exceptions, certain cities belonged to certain princes. That if you wanted that city that was next to a trade route that you wanted, it was not just I go and conquer the city, I have to eliminate or take over that dynastic branch. I know this concept is problematic, and I know this has going to be a lot of, oh, excuse me, but if and, yes, but it was a way of trying to understand that the dynastic wars were coming after the disposition of the cities belonging to a given dynasty. At least we have tried to map that as the situation was at the end of the 13th century. We cannot, unfortunately, account for every single change, but we have tried to give a bigger picture with all the possible caveats. The places that were mentioned in the sources, as some were, for example, mentioned in the PVL, in the Povestbremen ich liet, but for which we don't have coordinates. We have not been able to find coordinates. No map has actually pictured them, not even the oldest and best maps of Rybakov and Tikhomirov. Those places that were not, whose coordinates were not even approximate, are not in MAPPA. So if you find a village in a text in the PVL or in a life of a saint, and sometimes it doesn't appear, it's because we cannot really trace it down. Whenever we have had coordinates that we can trace down, we have done so. And even if they were approximate, we have done so. When a place appears as non-extant, means that there are only ruins, it's not inhabited anymore, but nevertheless, the ruins are attested as being those of the place so-and-so. So those who were not even in ruins, not even approximate, and not even, they are not in the MAPPA, unfortunately. We had to take that decision because otherwise it would be impractical and basically we cannot link them to anywhere. And just a final thing, because I leave the floor to Kostya, the foundation of the years of the places have to be the first appear of that place in a written record. It's been we have applied a brutal, merciless law on this, and we know that there are you know, evidence or secondary evidence that there was actually life in that place before it is mentioned in a chronicle. But we had to apply a criteria that was our criteria. You can also, as you will see, search the places by where, in which chronicle are they mentioned for the first time. But the foundation year or the it's actually the mentioning year, as we understand it, for the cities. In the case of the buildings, monasteries, churches, civic buildings, as you will see in a minute, when we had a fork of years, for example, so-and-so started to build this monastery and so, sometimes even, you know, another prince or another, or a son or a nephew or something, finished it. The date that we gave as valid is a date of consecration. So not when it started to be built, but when it started to function. Again, we had to take a decision because MAPPA is a wonderful thing, but it has its requirements as any software. And we had to sort of, also cater for those. So without further ado, I'm going to leave the floor now to Kostya. Kostya, the floor is all yours. I'm going to stop sharing so you can share.
Thank you, Susanna. That was very interesting. I've learned a lot. I did tell you, give me everything you have. I didn't realize it's going to be that much, though. But I'm glad you did. And so what we have done, though, is not obviously everything that Susanna has, and there will be a lot more. And all the other stuff is in development. So I will start by sharing my screen. Okay, so can you see? Can you see my screen now? Okay. So for those of you who are already familiar with the MAPPA project, the platform that the Golden Age of Kievan Rus is based is the same as platform that we used for other modules. So if you've used other modules in our program, you'll be familiar with this module as well. It will be easy transition for you. This module falls under the Historical Atlas. So this is our fourth edition to this atlas. So the historical atlas is definitely growing, and the module itself will be growing as well. From this main page of our website, you can go straight to the module page, and from here you can click on this link, and I believe the link to the actual web map application is posted in the chat. So I have already opened that. Again, for those who are familiar with this, this may be repetitive, but if you don't know, I have to give you a very quick overview of how this works. Many people are a little surprised when they open the web map application that they see absolutely nothing, basically, except for the base map. In our case, we even removed the borders from the base map, so you don't even see really anything on this base map, but you can change the base map if you go here and you can choose one of the base maps in this window, but I'm not gonna do it for now, but you can change and you see the border, the modern borders of the countries. On the left, you can see for now, we have included only five tools, five widgets. This will also grow with the time when we find a need or an application for a new tool. For now, you see the layers list, the query list. We have created two widgets for the time slider that will be enacted on two different places and monasteries, and the filter tool. On the left, under the layers, you see some of the check boxes are checked, some of the boxes are checked, and some of them are not. The ones that are checked are group layers. That means if you click on this little triangle to the left, you will see more layers that will open up that belong to that group layer. And you can see this subgroup layer has its own number of layers as well. So by default, none of the layers are enabled, only the group layers are enabled, which makes it easier so you don't have to enable the group layer and the layer. You can just enable a layer in a group and it will be visualized in the window on the right. There are a couple of tools here as well, plus and minus, where you can zoom in and zoom out. Information about the project. You have seen already the base map catalog and the legend. Same legend as you can see under the layer. When you combine several layers, all of them will show up in this legend window as well. And the home button, if you zoom in or if you pan out of here left or right, you can always go back to the predefined home extent. Now let me go. So this is how you enable disable layers. On top, also the important thing here that if you see there is a hierarchy here, whatever is up on top always will be visualized on top of the layer that is beneath it. So in some cases it's important because you may have one layer open and then you see it, like I just enabled this layer extend today and you see nothing. Well, that is because the layer above it overrides whatever is under that layer. So you won't be able to see it. So you only combine two layers that will not overlap. You may want to combine this, for instance, with the something that is different. You see, I'm opening here and I'm looking for different symbology. And probably the best one in this case, we could combine this. Doesn't look very visually nice, but you see the possibility when you combine dots and bars, at least you can see that this way you can see both layers. As Susanna mentioned that we have a lot of information that was put in a database, and the database is then linked to the layers are linked to the database. But if you ever want to see what's in the database, you go to these three dots on the right and you click on view in attribute table, and the values will show up here in the attribute table. And why would you want to do that? Because when you start using filters and queries, you may want to go through the actual fields with the values and find out which field, which value you can copy from here, and then you can then use that value in your search. So let's go, for instance, to this layer that includes all the places. So these are all the places that we have so far, all geocoded here. So this is the attribute table for them. And let's say I'm looking in one of these and I see there's land of that Susanna just referred to. And let's say I would want to filter some of these results. What if I don't want to see all the places? But if you click, by the way, that's another thing I just missed. But if you click on the actual symbol, you'll see a pop-up window with the information. Pretty much the same information that you see here is organized here, but in more, it's more organized here. It's not just the whole database, it's just the selected values that we decided would be most useful for people in this pop-up window. So for here, if we, for instance, if we go, I can zoom in, and that's another feature you want to see, that not all the labels will be visible right away. So you have to sometimes zoom in and you will see more of the labels showing up. So if I pick this, you can just copy this value from land of century, 13th century. And see, this layer has to be enabled for the filter to work. So we'll just go quickly to this filter. Okay, and you can apply the filter to any layers, but you want to have the layer enabled first for the filter to work. Then we go to cities, we go to places, all, because that's the layer that is enabled at this time. And then we can add an expression here and we'll say, you've seen it in the pop-up window, I picked from this field. I'm just gonna paste that here. I'm gonna enable. And what do I have here? I have only the places that belong to that land. And if you can click on them, you can see that's where they belong. They can just disable this filter. Again, remember that the filter applies only to an active layer. The difference between the filter then and the query will be the query is something that we predefined here. Let me just go and disable this. So again, you have a blank map basically with a basic base map, but you go to, and again, like I said, all these categories, the tools and the predefined queries will be expanded with the time. For now, we just have a couple of them just for you to get an idea how this works. So if, so this one is City Chronicle first mention. If you go back here and you see, and you click on any of these place names, Chronicle first mention, you have this name. So again, we can pick one name out of here. Let's just pick this one, Laurentian. Can disable this. I go to the query here and I'm just gonna paste this here and this will be my new layer I'm creating right now. Okay, so these are all the places you can see here in this window on the left in this pane, the description for every one of the places that this query was just performed on, and these are the results that were returned. Now, when you go back to the layer list, you see there's a new, brand new layer that we just created on the fly. We gave it a name. This layer was not in the predefined list of layers. So we just created this layer interactively. And we can even go so far as add. If you click on them, again, you can see the same information that you see here on the left. You can see it in the pop-up, in the pop-up window. Then we can just disable this. And we can actually go back to this tab, the results, and we can just remove this as a the result and see it has disappeared here from our list. So the idea is that first we're gonna have a lot of information here, but and it will be put in a database. Then we will selectively create layers based on the database. Yet you as a user, you will be able to select to create more layers when you when you use tools like filter or query. And two more tools that we have here, they kind of give you a different visualization because we always talk about the geographic coordinates, but the other aspect of the database is the time. We also have the coordinates, but they are also mapped through the time, through different years. So if you, in a little hint for you to use, so you see in parentheses, I indicated which layers have predefined pop-up windows and which layers can be used with the predefined tools here. So again, this is the same layer all places. Now we're gonna use, you have to enable this layer though that says use with time slider for the time slider to work. And then we'll go to the time slider and you can see we have this window at the bottom. You can either play step-by-step or we can just enable play automatically. You can even increase the speed here. And you can see when the time slider moves, you have places showing up depending on the year of foundation. You can pause this, you can play it back, or you can go, forward, or you can play it back, and you can see places disappear because we're going back in time. So these are very basic functionalities that you don't have to feel overwhelmed. A lot of the past MAPA presentations have more extensive explanation of the layers and tools. So here I only had about 10 minutes to do that. So we obviously haven't covered all of that. But again, if you look at the videos of the previous presentations, or you can also go to our website and we have resources there with the help resources where we describe many of these tools and we have other videos that include explanations of these tools.
Kostya, could you show please the lens off?
Yes, we can do the lens off. Yeah, just a second. It's under silk structures, so I'm gonna disable this one. Collapse this. So these are places by land. So what we did here, we color coded places that belong to different lands. And you can see they're also differentiated with the size of the font that we used for the places. The bigger places we use larger fonts, and then we use smaller fonts depending on the size of the place. Same idea is applied here under cities, where you have cities by relevance. As you can see, we have different symbology and font size for the size of the places. And here, if you zoom in, you see more information about them. And this layer as well, you can take a filter, you can apply a filter quickly on this, and you will only see a places belonging to one land or the other land.
And could you show the monasteries with a pop-up, please?
Yes, I'm sorry, that's right. The other one that is actually interesting and looks visually very nice, I think, and gives you kind of a different perspective on the whole thing. This is the list of the monasteries. And again, you see in the parentheses I indicated here that this layer includes a pop-up window. And some of them overlap, unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know, it just happened like that a lot of them clustered and very close to each other. So you have to zoom in and you will see that more icons and more labels will show up on the zoom in. And then very carefully, you have to find the center of this symbol. This one doesn't have an image, but this has a description of the monastery. So you have the founder's name, the year of the founder, and if it's princely founded or not, and also the gender of the monastery. And I'm gonna try to find one with a nice image. Happens to be no images in these two, so I'm just gonna pan out here. And this one has an image. You can click on the image and the image will open in a large window on the side as well. Anything else, Susanna, you can think of? No, okay. All right, thank you. So if you have any questions, we're gonna have Q&A now.
I just wanted to thank you, Kostya, once again, before we go to the Q&A. And also thank, because I forgot before, Michael Flyer, Serhii Plochy, and Michelle Wiese, because it's really a project of, and even Megan, who gave us the ideas for the colors of the lands. It is really a Huri project. It's been a wonderful, you know, effort put together, and I didn't want to forget any of the names. So thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you all. So I'd like to go to the Q&A. First of all, thank once again, Susana and Kostya for this wonderful and interesting presentation with all the possibilities there. So let's open up the floor to questions, and they can come either directly, I guess if I can see anybody's hand, or can I, or through the chat. So let's see, I have one here from Oleg Brenman. What about the timeline? Is it possible to see a chronological map? I mean, how the Iris looked in year XXX?
Yes, so you go to, I have to share the screen, just give me a second.
While you do that, that depends on what actually do you want to see at what time of the, at which span of the, what fork of years. So in the sense what Kostya was explaining, like what you activate the layers. So maybe you say, and maybe we have not put all the information, but you say, okay, I want to see how many monasteries were between this year or in that century, or I want to see how many cities were built. That you can enable, but in order to, for us to have a timeline, we have to define a criteria. So Kostya is going to show you more on that, on
right.
The timeline.
So you can choose here. Can you see my screen now, right? Okay, so I went to the back to this places all, right? And I click here. And these are the fields that we have for the temporal fields are foundation year and century founded. So let's pick century founded 11, right? So then we'll go here and we'll go to the filter. Remember, this has to be enabled for us, add an expression, and we'll go to century. Yeah, and we're gonna put 11. Okay, so these are all the ones, just check quickly, that were founded in the 11th century. So this is for the whole century, and you can do it just by year. Then you're gonna go here, and instead of century founded, you're gonna go to foundation year, and there was what, 1030. Try the same thing. And how many places? We have two places that were founded in 1030. So this is how the filter would work. And remember, we also have the widget for the time slider, which works on the cluster of places within the interval that we defined here. In so I'm gonna go here. Yeah. Okay. So 10. So what the step here is 25 years. So every time I click on the step, see there is an increase in 25 years. So that's how this layer works. So basically between the filter and between the time slider, there are different ways of finding places through time.
Okay, thank you. Let's go on to the next question. I see that Donna Ostrowski has raised his hand. Don, are you there? Are you unmuted?
Here we go. Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so I was typing in, I have a correction for Susana, a comment and a question. Okay, the correction, very important one. It is technically Shevchenko's Law of the Dog and the Forest. Okay. The comment concerns, this is a great project. This, you know, as Shevchenko would say, bravo. what occurred to me, however, if you are going to modify Mortensen's different categories of canon and archive to include pseudo-epigrapha and apocrypha, then because a monk, medieval Rus monk, would not see them the same way a modern day scholar would, okay, then where might it not be also possible to consider how a medieval Rus monk or literary person would see these things? For example, yes, the PVL canon, yes, it's foundation. Slovo Epoka Igoreva, no. There's no trace of it until you get to maybe Zadonshchina. So how there would be an overlap of these categories, I'm sure, but there would be differences. And I think that might be, as a historian, I'm interested in those historical differences. The question concerns something Kostya said, which is the size, the font size of the designation of the places based on the size of the places. How does one determine the size of the places?
I'm afraid, Kostya, sorry, but I'm afraid that is my fault. We have determined the size of the places following Tikhomirov, Krivnoruskaya Gorodá, and therefore he gave three categories and we have followed those categories. It's arguable, but that's in the description of the project and it's in the bibliography. It's arguable, and that's why we put, he divided them in capitals, relevant cities, and cities with villages, which is cities with the taxes of those villages were paid to, and therefore we have followed exactly his description. As I said, it's arguable, and that's the great thing about our digital project. We only have to all be very careful not to make Kostya run out of patience. But another category or another form can be uploaded if a better understanding or a newer understanding is found. I follow Tikhomirov because it was good enough to a certain extent for me at this point. Like, for example, if you go to the legend of the categories, you will also see the dates of the other archbishoprics are always debated. When was, for example, Bielohrad as an archbishopric or not? I have followed Arignon in his famous article of the growth of the church in Kievan Rus. Arignon, Jean-Paul Arignon, some people might agree with him, some people might not, but I have not entered into the discussion to a certain extent of which is what you can do as a historian. Which also links to, if I may, Michael, abuse your patience as chair, answer your first question or your first comment about the monk. This is a website made for modern researchers, not for medieval monks. And therefore, what I think our duty is to offer you the tools, the construction of the narrative behind what was the understanding of the Act of Pilati, if it was in the service for Lent in the Good Friday night, or it was just understood as something fantastic or whatever that. Or how they even the medieval monk understood it, that is the part of the researcher that has to then negotiate and write articles about. What the only thing we want to provide as any cataloging archive is the instruments for scholars to write with and as, to make them as accurate as possible. I understand what you're saying, and I'm not even going to enter the Slovopolku Igory question because this is going to kill us. But we give you the tools, and that's why I insist on making them with as much connection with other fields and scholarly experts from other fields as possible, so other people, every one of us, can work with it. So this is just a sort of a showcasing of everything that was there, not an understanding of everything that was there. That is for you and many others to do.
Okay, we have a question from Philip Cox. What happens with alternate spellings and places that were renamed? Is it all just based on the current name?
Thank you for that question. It's a very good question. Michelle Wiese, which I don't know if she's around today, but she was a wonderful, wonderful help because she has gone through all my sometimes very bad transliterations. What we have used are HURI, so the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute names as primary names. Now, when you display in a pop-up like Konstantin has shown you, then you would have all the other possible names. You would have the PVL name, if we have one. We would have, or the attested source name, if we have them. We have the modern Ukrainian name, the modern Russian name, and the modern English name. So for each dot that you see, even the smaller ones in the smaller print, you have five names. Some of them coincide, some of them don't, but we have a respected HURI naming.
If I may add, in the search field, you can use any of those and it will work for any of those variants.
Mm-hmm.
It will, you can add, you know, that's how the search, I didn't have a chance to show that, but it will work for all of them.
Okay. Do we have any more hands up? Yeah, so you already answered my question about the different sizes of time of the towns, because I was wondering whether reference had anything to do with that. Would obviously would play into the notion of notable towns as opposed to lesser ones. What about where? Let me ask both of you going into this particular project. Were there any issues that arose that were totally unexpected and now have opened up new terrains of possibility to explore? Anything that you didn't expect to find or see that you had to suddenly face and deal with?
Kostya, do you want to answer or shall I?
You can go ahead. I think my issue was with the interval, like what interval to choose, mm-hmm. 5 years, 25 years. That was kind of difficult because some of the clusters will show up within such a short period of time. Then for a long time, you have nothing. So, and the unfortunately, the software doesn't allow you to fine tune it to like, so I had to just pick an interval, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So, go ahead, Susanna.
Yeah,
no, and I think that Sergio also was asking something similar. I mean, for me, it's been like super eye-opener because, one works with, really, thank you, Don, with the dogs and the forest. But one works with one things and doesn't realize the extent of the how the cities were distributed. For example, I remember being with Kostya when we actually mapped the extent and the non-extent, and maybe Kostya can show it later. But when you put the non-extent layer, you see perfectly well the Mongols coming because all those cities were destroyed. And so you see all this tongue of destruction coming from the east to the west, things like that. When you actually see them, the amount of monasteries, again, I had not, honestly, this one? Yeah.
Yeah.
This I had not realized, for example, the clustering. So the you know, of the destruction, the number of monasteries, for example, in the north or in the, you know, in different areas. Yeah, I think the visualizing in a surface, it's certainly for me, and also using, as we have seen, the colors and all that, makes you understand several things. I have a better understanding of the dynastic question, certainly, and a better understanding of the different sharing of power and in mm-hmm. between all the different regions or lands of in Kievan Rus. But I have one of those things, as anybody has done a project like this in digital humanities, the person who benefits the most is the person making it, because by just thinking about the data, how to put the data, which data can I upload in which form, only that is a learning process. So yeah, I've learned loads.
Okay, so as long as we're talking about unexpected differences, that topic, I have a question from our institute director, Serhii Plokhii. Congratulations on completing the first stage of a very important project. I wonder whether after placing your data on the map, you've already seen something that you have not seen before. Are there any new research questions that have been generated by this process?
Susanna, you're muted.
You're muted.
Sorry, Kostya, do you want to go ahead or shall I?
Oh, you go ahead. You're definitely the expert.
No, I mean, for me, the questions, as I said, one of the things I have understood better, certainly, as I mentioned just a moment ago, the question of dynastic succession and the dynastic wars. And the avenues that are opening is that I have to confess, when we first thought about uploading for this presentation, I thought, okay, the monasteries is okay, it's 30 names with all the descriptions and the photographs and all that, but it's only 30. It surprised me. I didn't know there were so many feminine monasteries, actually, at such an early stage. That completely kind of ka-chung, because I knew there were feminine monasteries later, but before the pre-Mongol was something like, wow. And also when we found that's why I made the layer of princely foundations or not. I had also always assumed they were all princely foundations, and apparently they're not. that was another surprise. And certainly when we were trying, and Kostya knows about this, at the end I had to give up. There were something like 350 something churches. And I thought, Kostya, I don't have the time. But the amount of building, I mean, a lot of building, and you see, for example, Novgorod, and there's bars that Kostya has shown, and the proportion of churches and the proportion of churches and monasteries built in Kiev and in Novgorod. And when I counted, and I don't know if Kostya can show it, like when I counted number of churches, 12th century, 13th century Novgorod, and there were like a phenomenal number. And the first thing that came to my head is Venice, because in Venice, you just go to a street and there is one church. And that of course tells you a lot about, I'm not saying, you know, the typical endless question of the decline of Kiev, but certainly there was a lot of money to build, you know, church institutions, churches, monasteries and all that only in the city of Novgorod. That, for example, when I counted them down, that actually blew my mind. I didn't realize there were so many. And I go to Novgorod every summer, but I had not realized the extent to which they were. Yeah, thank you, Kostya. Thank you, Serhii. Thank you for giving us this opportunity, actually, for developing all this.
Okay, I think that our time has come to an end. I do want to, first of all, thank our panelists again, Susana Torres Prieto and Konstantin Bondarenko, for their fascinating material. And I look forward to many more interesting possibilities from this project. So as I mentioned earlier, this is the last seminar for the fall semester. We will resume beginning with a teacup conference, the Temerty Center for Ukrainian Politics, a conference that goes from February 7th to 11th. And we want to make special note of the keynote lecture by Ambassador Marie Jovanovic on Wednesday, February 9th at 12 p.m. So thank you all again, and we will see you in the winter.